The name of this video is Joule's Law. Local. If you consider an electrical wire, like the one sketched here, let's say this made of copper, we know that within this conductor, we have positive ions, which are fixed in space, and negative charge free carriers, the electrons, which can move and bounce against each other, as well as against the positive ions. So every time we have a collision between a pair of electrons, or an electron and ion, or an electron and the Helmholtz double layer on the edges of this conductor, we have inelastic collisions. And so inelastic collisions result in energy loss. Where does it go to the energy? This energy effectively becomes heat. And what is the law which allows us in conductors to understand how heat is formed in these conductors in presence of an electric current J? Well, this is Joule's law. So how do we proceed to find out? Well, first of all, we consider an infinitesimal filiform flux tube. Okay, what is this? So it's a flux tube, as we've seen before, a spaghetto, but in this case in particular, so this is a cross section on one side. The spaghetto itself is also infinitesimally long. So the length of the spaghetto is dl, or this filiform flux tube. The cross-sectional areas are dA everywhere. And so this object we take in the neighborhood of a point capital P within this conducting object, anywhere within this object. And so in this case, we know that the longitudinal axis, for example, of this infinitesimal flux tube, it looks like that. So around this point capital P, we can set a tangent unit vector T, which is the orientation of dl, so tdl is my oriented element dl. And similarly, at this point here on the surface, I can define a normal unit vector n. And actually, as it turns out, these two quantities in this specific case are exactly the same. And so now here, if I have a vector density, current density j, so j is directed as t or n, if you want. In particular, j has to be the same at each point on these areas, because of course they're infinitesimally small, and it's also infinitesimally short. So it's basically this infinitesimal filiform flux tube. What it does, it identifies a single j at a single point, okay? Just to make it clear. So now that we have that, we know that the quantity dq associated with j, we have seen this in a previous video, is given by rho b, which is j, dot n, with these definitions, dA dt. We have seen this in a previous video when we have done the current density, actually, where we introduced j. So what is the work, dW, that the electric field associated, we know if there is a j, there must be an electric field E. For example, these are related by Ohm's law, as we've seen in a previous video. What is the work that E does to move this charge dQ by a certain length dL? Well, it's nothing but dQ times E dot dL vector, which is tdL, using these conventions here. All right. And so this, we can rewrite it using this definition here of dQ as J dot N dA dt, which is dQ, times E dot tdL. As it turns out, T and J, they have the same direction. They are parallel. Okay, so dL and J are parallel because it's an infinitesimal filiform flux tube. Let me write it down so that we're on the same page. So this is not only a filiform, but it's an infinitesimal, because infinitesimally long, it's not finite length, infinitesimal filiform flux tube. All right, so in this case, we can very simply swap the role of TDL here and J, because TDL and J are the same direction. So if I project E along TDL with the dot product or along J, I should get the same result. And so I can write DW as simply S, J, since it's abelian, I can do J.E or E.J is the same thing. So I do J.E, and let me remind this again. So J and TDL are parallel, so projecting E along this TDL is the same as projecting E along J. Same result, same cosine, same angle. Abelian, so I can do J.D or G.A or E.J, same thing. And the leftover is going to be N dot T from here. And we have dA, dL, dT. Now, interestingly enough, this quantity, of course, gives me one because they are parallel, as I wrote here. And so this quantity, effectively, is nothing but dADL, which is dB. So it gives me J dot E dB dt. So if I want to take the power from the work, I need to divide dW the work by the time dt. And so I obtain J dot E dB. Of course, I can also integrate it to find the integral form. But instead of doing that, let's assume that we have, for example, let's assume that we have an ohmic conductor. And so we can write, for example, either J S equal to S constant times E, or if you want, we can also write E equal R J, one of these two forms. So if we use this inside this expression, we find two possible expressions for the power. So the power, let's write it just pi. So this is this power here, in the case of ohmic conductors. But in that case, supposed to use the first one, so we substitute J with S E, so we get S E dot E, which is E squared dB. And in the other case, we obtain equivalently, the power can be written as, let's substitute E, so we have RJ, so we get R J absolute value square dB. And of course, again, if I want it per unit volume, I just divide by dB. So these are important quantities here, which we could also write in integral form by integration. Okay, so to summarize this video, what we've seen here, we consider the case of a conductor because of inelastic collisions of the electron among themselves with the ions or with the walls of the conductor, there is energy loss because of inelastic collisions, therefore heat. We consider an infinitesimal filiform flux tube, which allows us to, with the budget definitions, to write down the charge dQ associated with this flux tube, therefore the work required to move this dQ by a quantity dL, this is the work. We use this concept of parallel J and TDL so that we can swap things in this equation and therefore obtain the famous result J dot E, which again gives by dividing by dT the power per volume dV. And so then we use Ohm's law in local form to obtain two particular scenarios of this power, two particular representations of this power if Ohm's law for an ILH, isotropic linear homogeneous material, is true. That's it.